I can't cry when I talk about NIH. I remember distinctly, Dr. Rosenberg walked in with his team and he looked Rich right in the face and said, I have big plans for you. He gave us hope.
My name is Richard Schlueter. I am 56 years old. I live here in Brookhaven, Georgia, with my wife, Michelle.
I'm Michelle. We have three beautiful children, and we've been fighting this beast for over 18 months.
I've always taken my health very seriously. I saw my doctor in January of 24, and I literally got a clean bill of health that everything looked great. I was laying in bed about 2 weeks after I had had my physical, and I was noticing at night that I had sort of a metallic taste in the back of my throat. And I went, turned on the light in the bathroom, and I saw some really small white pustules that were on the right side of my tonsil. Went to the doctor the next morning. He asked me to go ahead and follow up with an ENT. I was very concerned. We have a relative who's a radiologist. I called him from the car and he said, well, you can come on over and I'll go ahead and do a CT scan. After the scan, he came back out and told me, well, I found something. And my heart just dropped. I called my doctor and told him this is what we found. He scheduled me the next day to go and see a local oncologist. And the PET scan confirmed that it was a head and neck cancer. This all happened within about a week to 10 days. And I went from having a very normal life to being really turned upside down. They scheduled me with the proton therapy and 7 weeks of chemotherapy. We started treatment on my 55th birthday on March 11th and finished my treatment right at the end of April. So my scan was scheduled for July 31st. That evening, I get the information that pops into my portal that is the read from the radiologist and the PET scan that shows three more suspicious masses. And so here I'm showing metastatic spread of disease. And here it is again, being given this information and having to walk in and tell my wife.
It was awful. And it's like 7 o'clock at night and we just were in shock because, you know, you go from a cure rate to you're metastatic.
We immediately then started scouring and looking for additional places to get second opinions. And we got second opinions at some of the finest institutions that our country has to offer. We settled on, based upon a clinical trial, to start therapy at MD Anderson. We treated for about 3 months, and I was showing that I was progressing on the drug, so it was clear that I needed to get another treatment. How I got to NIH was convoluted. A scientist out in Seattle had sent me a number of articles dealing with metastatic spread head and neck cancer. And one of the articles that he sent to me was dealing with a particular clinical trial at NIH. And I reached out. They invited me to come to the facility at Bethesda to then go through all their tests to determine if I was eligible.
It was mid-January and he had to go through his second lung biopsy.
Yes.
So they found a tumor that they could take a piece of.
From there, they then send it to the lab to determine if it grows. And if you have reactivity and you have good growth, then you then qualify for the expansion of those cells to be then sorted and selected, enriched, and reinfused back.
It was St. Patrick's Day that we found out he was good. His cells were good.
So the goal was always to get this opportunity of having this cell therapy done on June 3rd. And that's when I was told that it was no longer 3 weeks, but was 8 to 10 weeks to get in for them to basically start doing the expansion of the cells because of the budget cuts.
It was like the rug was ripped out from underneath us. He had so much spread and just started to go downhill right after that. We knew we were delayed because of budget cuts, and my kids really, instead of being upset, they decided to do something about it. We started calling and texting and getting in touch with congressmen. We were fighting this battle privately, And we decided once we came out, we were going to come out loud and we were going to make change. If this is going to be seen by congressmen and women, I would say a lot of people will die if you cut off cancer funding.
If we stop doing innovation, we stop looking towards treatment and care.